Good morning. Glad to see everybody this morning. We're so glad that you're here. Let's stand together as we worship and sing, and let's lift high the name of the Lord, singing your name.
As morning dawns and evening fades, you inspire songs of praise that rise from earth to touch your heart and glorify your name. Your name is a strong and mighty tower. Power to say but your name, Jesus, in your name we pray. Come and fill our hearts today, Lord, give us strength to live for you.
Praise the Lord this morning.
Good morning. I hope everyone is having a wonderful morning. So glad to see everyone here in the house of the Lord this morning. And I just hope y'all are ready to hear the word and to praise God through it all. So this morning, I know a lot of people are out for summer festivities, but summer's almost over. And we'll be getting back here shortly, but once again, it is such a blessing. If you are new or visiting, we welcome you. We hope you feel welcome here, and we just hope that you see the Lord move in a mighty way. But if you're here, then you're here. Holla. Y'all just stay with us, okay? But let's pray this morning, and then we'll fellowship. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I just thank you for this day. I thank you for all that you do for us, God. I just pray, Lord, that you are in this place. God, we invite you into this place, Lord. Open our hearts and minds this morning to receive you, to receive your words, to receive your tugging on our hearts, God. I just thank you for who you are, God. I just pray, Lord, that you just bless each and every person in here, God. Bless their families, Lord, and just protect us as we go about our days. Lord, I just thank you for who you are and all that you've done for us. In your precious, wonderful name I pray. Amen. Let's fellowship in the name of the Lord.
Thank you.
Amen, amen. As we make our way back to our seats, let's join together in worship singing Have Faith in God, hymn number 508.
Yonder on Calvary's mountain.
break. Father God, we love you, and dear Lord, what a privilege it is to be in your house today to serve and praise you, dear Lord. And Father, we just ask you to bless our tithes and offerings today. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Ms. Billy Lou. Picture this. You're a football player. You're playing in the national championship against the number one team in the nation. And this team that you're going up against has won every year for the past 12 years. And it's actually been ages since your team has even made it to the playoffs. In fact, your team is so known for losing that half of the players' parents don't even show up to the games. But this year, by the grace of God, you made it to the national championship, which is unheard of. But all odds are against you. As you look across the field, you soon realize that you're not playing against boys anymore. No, these are grown men. And every prediction is that your team won't even score a touchdown the entire game. The other team is bigger, they're stronger, they're faster, they're smarter, and they're all around better than your team will ever be. Now picture this. You're a cheerleader on a team heading to Worlds to compete. And you didn't necessarily make it there by skill. But something happened along the way to another team and they were disqualified and you were the only other team to compete because you were the only option left. But all season you have been performing poorly as a team and right now it just looks like you're going to be the laughingstock of the entire competition. Picture this. You're a boxer. And you've been training for month after month, getting ready to go into this fight. But this isn't an ordinary fight. See, your opponent stands 6 inches taller than you with about 200 more pounds on you. And he's a brutal savage who hasn't lost in his 8 years of boxing. Now picture this. You're a shepherd boy who is the youngest of 8 brothers, all of whom are great and mighty men, but you occupy your time tending to the flocks of the family, doing nothing important. And a man comes to you telling you that the Lord is making you king over all the nation. And one day, as you bring food to your brothers in the midst of a war, you hear an enemy throwing out insults against the God you serve and worship. But this is no ordinary enemy. In fact, this enemy stood, according to some ancient Hebrew manuscripts, to be 9'6" tall. And you're only about 14 years old. I'd say about 5'2". But not only is this enemy so much taller than you, he is also so much heavier. His armor alone weighing in at over 300 pounds. So what do? There's no way you can fight against this man. There's no way that you can stand before this warrior. No one else from your nation's army will go against this giant, even though he is mocking the God you serve. What are you going to do? Let's read about it this morning. If you would, turn with me in your Bibles to the book of 1 Samuel. This morning we will be looking at chapter 17 of this book and studying verses 40 through 51. So let's take a look at these verses this morning. They say this, and they're going to be on the screen as well. It says, "Then he took his staff in his hand, and he chose for himself 5 smooth stones from the brook and put them in a shepherd's bag. And a pouch which he had, and his sling was in his hand, and he drew near to the Philistine. So the Philistine came and began drawing near to David, and the man who bore the shield went before him. And when the Philistine looked about and saw David, he disdained him. For he was only a youth, ruddy and good looking. So the Philistine said to David, 'Am I a dog that you come to me with sticks?' And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. And the Philistine said to David, 'Come to me, and I will give your flesh to the birds of the air and the beasts of the field.'" Verse 45 says, "Then David said to the Philistine, 'You come to me with a sword, with a spear, and with a javelin. But I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, with the God of armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This day the Lord will deliver you into my hand, and I will strike you and take your head from you. And this day I will give the carcasses of the camp of the Philistines to the birds of the air and the wild beasts of the earth, that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel. Then all this assembly shall know that the Lord does not save with sword and spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hands. 48 says, so it was when the Philistine arose and came and drew near to meet David, that David hurried and ran toward the army to meet the Philistine. Then David put his hand in his bag and took out a stone, and he slung it and struck the Philistine in his forehead, so that the stone sank into his forehead, and he fell on his face to the earth. So David prevailed over the Philistine with a sling and a stone, and struck the Philistine and killed him. But there was no sword in the hand of David. Finally, verse 51 says this, therefore David ran and stood over the Philistine, took his sword and drew it out of its sheath and killed him and cut off his head with it. And when the Philistines saw that their champion was dead, they fled. Pray with me this morning. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I just thank you, thank you, thank you for giving us breath, filling these lungs with breath this morning to give you praise. Lord, we are just so unworthy of everything that you pour out upon us, God, but we come before you humbly, Lord, lifting you up and thanking you for all that you've done in our lives. Lord, open our hearts and minds this morning to see that we need you to be able to conquer the giants in our lives. God, we invite you into this place, and Lord, we just pray that you let yourself be known this morning. I just thank you for this opportunity. Remove me. Help me to be transparent to your glory. In your precious name I pray. Amen. So this morning we're going to do things a little different. I'm going to ask y'all to participate. You're going to have to talk back if you don't mind. But that'll make everything better, okay? So just be ready. But the title of the message this morning is Slaying Giants. Turn to your neighbor and say, Slaying Giants this morning. And that's exactly what we're going to discuss this morning. Over the next 4 weeks, we're going to be diving into a series over how lives were changed because ordinary people are serving an extraordinary God. Let me say that again. Over the next 4 weeks, we're going to be discussing how people's lives were changed because ordinary people were serving an extraordinary God. Wow. So this morning we can't get those two things confused because man is nothing without God, but God is everything without man. And so the series itself is titled Giants, Grief, God, and Grace. And it's a 4-week journey of how ordinary people being used by an extraordinary God. So today, of course, is, as you guessed, giants. The first part to this series, and we're going to be looking at how an ordinary shepherd boy overcame the giants in his life. And so a lot is happening here in this chapter of 1 Samuel. So just in the previous chapter alone, chapter 16 of 1 Samuel, David, the little shepherd boy, is anointed king. Out of all of his brothers, out of all the other people that were fully qualified to be king, who in fact should have become king. We see here that God does not work ordinarily for man's desires. In Hebrew, David was referred to as katon, which stands for small or insignificant. His family had deemed him unworthy, unqualified, and all around useless for the position God was anointing him for, but God found favor in David. So what does that tell you this morning, church? It tells you that God's calling on your life doesn't look for the qualifications. It only looks for the willingness. So what does that mean? We're going to take it a step further. It means that it doesn't matter what anyone else thinks about what God has called you to do. It doesn't matter if you don't have any experience. It doesn't matter if you don't know what you're doing. It doesn't matter if you're the least qualified person for the job. If God is calling you to it, he will see you through it, as long as you are willing. And we see that in this passage of Scripture. David is faced with an enormous task. He has to go up against the one person no one else even wanted to look at. And David has all odds against us, against him. How many of us in here this morning have experienced something like that? Where all odds are against us, where everything seems to be crashing down and the enemy is standing over us, taunting us like we're nothing. See, David was just trying to take lunch to his brothers. He was just trying to bring them some food while they were at the camp, while they were supposed to be in battle. But as he stepped onto that battlefield, it became more than a mere lunch break. Something bigger than David was taking place. And there he stood before the soldiers, before the world, and before the giant. And there are people in here this morning that are standing before giants in their lives wondering what to do next. You are standing here before physical giants. You are standing here before emotional giants, mental giants, and spiritual giants. And when David stood before Goliath, he knew that the battle that was about to take place wasn't only physical, but it was spiritual as well. And he was fighting it on all fronts. And after David had composed himself at the brook and he gathered the stones together, Scripture says he drew near to the Philistine and the Philistine drew near to him. And as they stood face to face, the Philistine began to mock David because he was nothing. He was nothing compared to this mighty giant. And this morning, if you are sitting in here and you are facing a giant, it will taunt you. It will mock you, just as Goliath did to David. Because David wasn't anything special. He wasn't a giant. He wasn't older. He wasn't even a warrior like his brothers. David was an ordinary shepherd boy with nothing going for him at this point in his life. And that's us in here this morning. We are nothing special. We aren't bigger than the giants that are standing in front of us. We are just ordinary people standing before life and the obstacles it throws at us. But how we react to those giants in our lives will determine whether we are successful or not in the battle. As Goliath was taunting and mocking David because of his appearance, look at verse 45 with me to see how David responds to Goliath. It says, "Then David said to the Philistine, 'You come to me with a sword, with a spear, and with a javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied.'" David knew his strength alone was not going to be enough to fight this battle. And I am here this morning to tell you that your strength alone is not enough to fight the battle before you. It is only through the power of God that we can conquer our enemies. And David understood this, but sometimes in this life we think that we got this. And we tell ourselves, "I'm strong enough to handle this on my own. I can do this alone. I don't need the help of anyone." And when we step into that mindset and attack the situation by ourselves, we will always fail. There is no getting around that. And many of us have learned that the hard way. So David approached this battle knowing that who he was serving was bigger than himself, or even bigger than the giant in front of him. And that's what we have to remind ourselves when a giant arises in our life. We have to be able to stand across from whatever is before us and say, "I know I am not strong enough to defeat you. I know I don't stand a chance alone. I know you have the advantage, but my God is with me. And he wants to fight for me, and he will conquer you today." And as David had faith that what he was saying was true, God began to fill him up with the power to conquer this enemy. God gave him the authority to stand and fight because of his faith. And what happens next is just mind-blowing, blowing. Read with me verses 49 through 51 real quick. It says, "Then David put his hand in his bag and took out a stone, and he slung it and struck the Philistine in his forehead, so that the stone sank into his forehead, and he fell on his face to the earth. So David prevailed over the Philistine with a sling and a stone and struck the Philistine and killed him. But there was no sword in the hand of David. Therefore David ran and stood over the Philistine, took his sword and drew it out of its sheath and killed him, and cut off his head with it. And when the Philistines saw that their champion was dead, they fled." Wow. So David, this young, small shepherd boy, kills this 9-foot warrior with a sling and a stone. David was no warrior. Goliath stood before him as the champion. And David came at him with a sling and a stone. An ordinary boy being used by an extraordinary God was able to defeat the giant that stood before him in his life. And it was only through the power of God that he was able to do this. When you were younger, did you ever try to do things on your own? You know, you were like, you would tell your parents, "No, I don't need help. I can handle this on my own." And, you know, they would just step back and they would let you handle it so you could show them. How did that end up 9 times out of 10? Usually in disaster, right? And that's what happens when we try to do things outside of God. If David would have fought this giant by himself, there is absolutely no way that he would have been able to kill this giant. Because he allowed God to work through him, he was able to take that victory in his life. And some of us in here today have been trying to handle our own lives for too long. And God is standing back letting you handle things because you said you could, but it's ending in disaster. And it is time for you to let go of trying to run your own life and let God work through you so you can have the victory over these things that stand in your way in this life. And once we give up that control, we will finally conquer this thing. And sometimes it's the hardest thing in the world to do, to give up that power. It's hard to trust God that he's going to provide for us in times of need. And maybe David struggled with this. Maybe he had a hard time. But if he did, we know that he gave up his own will and fully trusted that God's power was enough to see him through. And that's all we have to get through this morning. If we can understand that God's power is sufficient in our lives, we will be able to go out and tackle this world and change it for his glory. We have to be able to say, "I can't live for myself anymore. I am nothing but an ordinary person trying to tackle things far bigger than myself. And I need someone extraordinary to be able to do that. I need God." And that's what David had to do. He had to go to the end of himself and find God there. Because God cannot come in if we're sitting on our own throne. So David kicked himself to the curb and said, "God, I need you. Give me your power." And because of that, he was able to soar above every giant that was in his life. And the more you read about David, and the more you see his struggles and the things that he faced in his life, you see that he was able to overcome them. And I want you to imagine what David was feeling in that moment. I want you to put yourselves in his shoes. There you are, standing over the giant. There you are, standing over the thing in your life that was hindering you this whole time. And you look down at it in awe, because all odds were against you. You weren't supposed to take that victory.
But you look at it and you call out its name. You say drug addiction, porn addiction, alcohol addiction, self-harm, toxic relationship, doubt, fear, giant. You raise your sword and with one swing, there it goes. Everything that was holding you down, everything that was holding you captive, gone in an instant. And when you finally let God use you to do extraordinary things in this life, and you conquer those giants, look at what happens next in verse 51. It says, therefore David ran and stood over the Philistine, took his sword and drew it out of its sheath and killed him and cut off his head with it. And look at this real quick. It says, when the Philistines saw that their champion was dead, they fled. When God gets rid of the giants in your life, the enemy will scatter. Because whenever God's work is evident, the enemy is exiled. There is no place for evil in the grace of God. And this morning, if you are struggling with giants in your life, if you are standing before the enemy and there seems to be no way to win, I encourage you to be like David. I encourage you to turn to God and let Him use you in an extraordinary way. What God was doing in David's life, He can do in your life. Because every day we wake up and we face giants, and a lot of times we don't know how to face them. So what do? We turn and we run, just like David's brothers. Each and every one of us in here this morning are struggling with a giant in our lives that we need to lay at the feet of Jesus. No matter what that giant is, I promise that there can be freedom this morning. God showed Himself in David's life because David had the faith that God was going to deliver him from his enemy. And if you don't have faith this morning that God can deliver you from something that you're facing, then you're never going to conquer that giant. In a few moments, we're going to open up the altar. And if you need to go to battle, now's the time. If you need to fight spiritual battles this morning, I encourage you to come to the altar and pray that God gives you the strength to conquer this giant in your life. There can't be one person in here that tells me that I'm not facing something right now. And just because someone can't see your struggle doesn't mean it's not there. There's only three types of people in this world. Ones who are in a storm, ones who just got out, and ones who are about to go back in. So you're always going to face a giant around the next curve. And how you respond and who you trust in will give you the outcome of this battle. And it will determine that. You have to come and fight this enemy, fight these giants in your life through the power of God this morning. And if you can do that, you can trust and proclaim victory. There is nothing you can do on your own this morning. But if you come to God, He will do everything. But that requires you to move today. So as Dylan and Ms. Billy Lou come play this morning. And I end in prayer. Know that you don't have to fight alone. Know that these giants, that these battles in your life are only temporary. And know most importantly that these little battles are hard and sometimes we lose, but God has already won the war. And you need to remind your enemy of that this morning. This life, it is a battle. And I don't know about you, but I want the one that has already won that war on my side. Amen. The question that you have to ask yourself this morning is, do I know him? And if you don't know him this morning, come. That is the giant that is in your life. You have to come to the end of yourself to meet Jesus. Because if you don't have Jesus this morning, then there is no way that you'll stand a chance before any giant that arises in your life. So first and foremost, if you don't know him, come to him this morning. He's pulling on you. But if you do, and you're fighting a battle right now in your life that you can't get over, maybe it's time you stop relying on yourself and come to him. Let's pray together this morning. Dear Lord, I just thank you. Thank you so much for your love. I thank you so much for the power that you have given us this morning. And all that you have done to conquer these giants in our lives, God. I just pray that you help us to fight these battles through you. Lord, give us the power. Give us everything that we need to overcome these giants in our lives. Lord, I pray that if anyone in here does not know you, they come to the altar this morning and receive you as their Lord and Savior this morning, God, and to put down themselves to accept you. God, I just thank you for all that you've done, Lord. And I pray that you move across this place. And it's in your precious name I pray. Amen.
As you respond how the Lord leads, let's stand together. We'll sing hymn number 440, Here I Am, Lord.
I will break their heart.
So good to see everyone this morning. I hope y'all are blessed. We do have a lot of church members that are fighting battles of their own right now, so I want us to be in special prayer for Miss Joy Evans, Seth Prescott, and I know there are many more who are fighting, and we just need to let them know that they are not alone, and that we are here to fight alongside them and pray for them and lift them up. But are there any announcements before we dismiss?
Choir practice will start back in 2 weeks, July 22nd at 5 o'clock. Be praying about it. It maybe if you've never been in choir before and you've been thinking about it, maybe been on the fence, it's a great time to join up and get started with us. And if you have been, we can't wait to see you again.
Any more announcements? Back to school drive is July 28th. Yeah, so any donations for school supplies, stuff like that, and clothing as well. It's a big event that we host every year, and it's always a blessing to be a part of. So that'll be July 28th, early that morning. Any other announcements before we dismiss?
Ryan, tonight, the regular activities.
So regular meetings tonight. Ladies, y'all are all meeting tonight? Oh, the Bible study is over for the ladies. The Hope class meets, though. And... All right. Any more announcements? Last call. All right. I'm going to pray for us, and then we'll be dismissed. Dear Father, Lord, I just thank you, God, for all that you've done this morning, Lord. I pray that you continue to move throughout this church. Lord, help us to go in the right direction, God, and give you the praise for every step of the way. Lord, at this time, I just lift up all those in our congregation that are struggling right now, that are facing giants in their lives that are hard to overcome. God, I pray, Lord, that you just use your power to move those giants in their life, God. I just pray, Lord, a special prayer for all of them. Miss Joy, Seth, and all those others who are sick and ill, God. I just pray, Lord, that you just bless them, touch them from the top of their heads to the bottom of their feet with your ultimate healing, and wrap them up in your loving arms. And I just pray, Lord, that this church steps up in loves on Brantley County to share your gospel and to further your kingdom. Lord, I just thank you for who you are. And it's in your wonderful and precious name I pray. Amen. Y'all are dismissed.